pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Chairman Greg Woods?
Here.
Vice President Bill Parkman?
Yep.
Secretary Don Morris here. Director David Rand is?
Here.
Director Gerald Morris is out ill and excused. Director Dennis Schaffner?
Here.
Director Justin Wright?
Here.
All accounted for.
All right. Item 4, adopt agenda.
I move to adopt the agenda as written.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion by Director Schaffner, second by Director Hernandez. Any discussion on the agenda? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Item 5, approved minutes. We have two sets of minutes here.
One is the one for April where we corrected something up in the roll call.
Well, that's right, because we have people that we're going to attend that time.
Yeah.
I make a motion to accept, we approve the minutes. First of all, the correct, let's go backward. The May 17th and then the April 19th corrected copy.
I'll second.
All right, motion is made by Director Morris, seconded by Director Wright. Any discussion on the minutes? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. All right. At this time, we have a guest speaker, Angela Sanchez from Roseman Little League.
Hi. Can I stand here? Yeah. So my name is Angela Sanchez. I'm here today representing Roseman Little League. I'm super nervous, so if I stumble over my own
words. We're just family.
Please excuse me. But I'm the president of Roseman Little League for the 2018 season. I've been on the board for about about 10 years, but 8 on like the actual board. I'm also a social worker for the County of Los Angeles, Department of Children and Family Services. I'm here to bring awareness to the county park and our Roseman Little League's role there. So Roseman Little League services approximately 350 children a season. Our season runs from about February 1st to July 31st. This season we are hosting 5 tournaments, one which is including senior state softball, which will bring in approximately 13 districts from different states as well as different towns around the United States to come here play for basically a World Series competition to go play at Williamsport in Pennsylvania. So it's a 13-day tournament. It hosts about 18 games. Our board hosts all of that. They run the snack bar, they set up fields, they...
How many fields do you have?
We have 2 fields. One field that will be working consistently. But it brings in a lot of revenue for the town. We have people who stay here, do double headers. The 7th and 8th will be 3 games back to back. So, you know, you'll have people going and eating at Foster Freeze, at McDonald's, also at our snack bar. That's where we kind of like encourage them to eat, obviously. So these tournaments are really important for us as a league because it allows us to have different districts and different teams come from all over Little League International to come play. It kind of puts Roseman on the map as a league that hosts these types of games. We use the county park at Glendower. Is everybody aware what park I'm talking about? The one off of Glendower and Rose Gold. So that is the field we rent it. And what I mean by we rent it, we reserve it with the county from those dates. We maintenance it. We provide any maintenance, so anything that's wrong with anything that relates to Roseman Little League functions, we pay out of pocket for that. We pay the lights over there. We also pay concession fees. So we pay that all to the county during the season. We pretty much maintenance the field over there, with the exception of cutting the grass and watering it, which we do sometimes during that time frame. So we also use the junior field, which is the bigger field, on Saturdays and during for our bigger games. So I kind of got off track, but my purpose of coming today is because I was told that there are sometimes county representatives here, and you guys also work very closely with the county in getting them different information. So what we're asking for and what we want to bring awareness as is we need help. We need help raising funds we have two primary goals. One of our goals is to put lights up on the junior field, which will allow us to open up our fields to more players. And what I mean by more players is that field is built for junior baseball level and higher, and softball, which right now we host maybe anywhere from 4 to 5 games a season. We can't really host any more because there's no lights over there. A lot of the teams that are playing in that level don't get out of school until 3:30, 4. They can't make a game until 6 or 7, and so those games are later in the day. For many years, Rosemond Little League has tried to save money to put in a pot to help the county in purchasing lights. Obviously, it's a huge expense. I don't have exact dollar amounts, but it's a huge expense. But I want county awareness that this is one of our goals in us fundraising, and also in reaching out just to the county in general and trying to come up with working with us as a board and also county workers, Parks and Recreation, to get with us to work with us in helping us raise the money for those lights on that field. My vision is, obviously, I'm in the field of social work, which is predominantly child welfare. To me, it's all about the kids. I feel that if we build strong youth programs in our community, we then send those youth to our high school and to our schools there, then build quality programs at the high school and at the youth at the schools. Then they send off to our. We then graduate them and send them off to our community to become great leaders and great community members. So I think athletics has a lot to do with that. Another huge funding issue we're coming into is, we are one of only 2 leagues that hosts that has a challenger team. Challenger team is for developmentally, physically disabled individuals. We for many years were the only league in our district. The district's made up of about 30 different leagues who has a all challenger team. This is for children who have developmental disabilities, cerebral palsy, spinal bifida, who are in wheelchairs. We have a longtime coach who has coached them for many, many years. We need help in making our dugouts more wheelchair accessible, more handicap friendly. A lot of these kids are get hot and they have heat stroke, like many of our other kids. But we need things like just maybe trying to put a water system in there so we have misters, there you go, in the dugouts during these times and stuff like that. So we definitely want just start creating awareness, keep this in the back of your guys' minds. If I need to come once a month to kind of help get county involved. I think we have a good relationship with county. I would say for the past 3 years we meet at the very beginning of every season with Parks and Recs. We go over what kind of needs to be fixed. This year they renovated our snack bar, which I don't know if any of you have ever came and looked at our snack bar, but it looks wonderful, so we do thank the county for that. So every year we give them kind of a project. The lights project obviously is a huge, more expensive project, a project we definitely want. We also have the community building over there, which we maintenance, we pay rent on. We maintenance everything, are responsible for any maintenance problems over there as well. So my goal was just kind of create a buzz in your guys' ear, get the county thinking about what we can do to work together and getting lights over there and getting our field more handicap accessible. Thank you.
What company is this?
It's a nonprofit.
No. Talking about like SBC sports. We have all these sports teams.
It's Roseman Little League. It's a nonprofit.
Okay, what's the? I understand that. You talking about the event that you're hosting?
It's through Little League International.
Little League International.
Yeah, which is also a nonprofit. Thank you.
Is this your first event that you're actually doing this?
No, we actually host tournaments every season. This is one of our bigger ones that we're hosting, but it becomes, be positive, it becomes a little tedious because we have a board, obviously, who works all season, and then we basically, the district comes in and asks us, can you host these tournaments? In the very beginning, everybody's like gung-ho, yes, we'll host it, but then our volunteership kind of follows off at the end, so it gets it gets to be maybe four or five of our families putting together the entire tournaments and stuff, so.
What has been done at all, if anything, about the lights? Has anybody approached the county or gotten estimates, or where is that in the process?
This is my first step. I've been president for about 3 years, and I've had little goals here and there. Last year, our goal as a board was to work on a snack bar. We kind of tried to do things that we were financially able to assist with. With us having a community building, that has kind of generated us some fundraising money that we're saving to help assist with the lights on that field. I want to say maybe 4 years back, we did get an estimate on how much it would cost the county to put lights on that field. They ended up putting brand new lights on the main field, if I'm not mistaken. So we didn't have to pay for anything for that. It was just something that needed to be done as far as, I believe, like safety reason wise, the poles were wood and they needed to be more structurally sound. So. We would be more than willing to make those steps in as a board to go forward with paying for an estimate, paying for plans. That's all stuff that we would be willing to take out of our money that we're fundraising for.
My suggestion right now, the counties have already developed their budget for the next fiscal year. So right now would be a good time for representatives from your organization to work with this board to get numbers and figures of what it's going to cost to put the lights up there. It's a benefit for the community. It's a county-owned park, and this way we can start opening up a dialogue with the right people at the county level to see if when they develop their next budget, if they can find the funding for doing it. But it's something that we need to start now, and because the wheels of government move very slowly, but it can be done to where when they develop their budgets for the next fiscal year, at least you will be in the mix, and to maybe it won't happen all at once. Maybe it might be just partial funding. Maybe they'll come up with part of the money and your organization comes up with the rest. But at the same time, you can work, we can work with the other the solar companies and other businesses in this community, that are willing to chip in a little bit here, a little bit there, and keep it focused on the fact that this is for the community youth. The youth of this community benefit from there being lights on that field. And so I would very much like to work with you guys on this, and hopefully we can get something moving forward. But it's right now we need to get numbers, because then we can take those numbers to the right people in the county, and then they can tell us what steps have to be followed to make this all happen.
That is exactly what I'm looking for. Point me in the direction. direction, and I'm here to make it work.
Well,
I come every month anyway.
Yeah.
I don't know if you got a copy of the agenda, but every month, item number 7, the community leader reports. There are various community organizations that come and give regular reports and updates on what's going on. And I would encourage you to take advantage of that, because even if you're not listed as one of these, we can do others, and we can certainly add them. Much like we do with Rosemond Youth Football and Cheer, so that we can get regular updates. And if someone wanted to get involved with your organization now, how would they do that? Is there a point of contact?
I'm your point of contact this year. I have been elected to be the 2019 president of Rosemond Little League as well. It is a very demanding job. I took on a new job as a social worker this year, so next year may or may not be my last year. But I am looking for, if I decide to leave next year, I will leave it in hands that are ready to move forward with what we're talking about now. And if I can't do that, then I will stay aboard to make sure our goals are met before I leave. So I'm here. I'll be here. Our season is coming to a close very quickly. July 31st is about when all of our tournaments will be done. I will like to take a little vacation, if you will, of Little League, probably the month of August. But I am more than willing to take any phone calls, any...
Really? At what number? See, what I'm trying to get at is, how do we contact you? So far, well, I'm here.
Yeah.
If we don't catch you now, we're not going to catch you. So
I will see you after and give you a phone number.
Do you have this one, the contact information?
I have her.
We will
is
give
it,
the
is
information.
It top
that
secret?
Is, that
and
is perfectly fine.
You want to give it out.
You can contact.
Did you want to give your number out at all or not?
Not on a public forum. No, I don't. But you
okay.
Can have it.
Well, all right. So if anybody wants to be involved, just leave a note on the door.
Sounds good. If that benefits you, that's more than welcome. I can give you an email address, though, if you like.
Oh, yeah. What's your email address?
Rosemond Little League.
Well, that's easy.
@yahoo.com.
Hey, Angela, I know it's going to be a busy month for you for July and stuff, but do you think you can set up a time to meet with a few of us on the board? Go ahead and contact Bill, and we can get some numbers, because then we can start making some phone calls to see what direction we need to go in, and then by the time you get back from your vacation in August,
I'm more than willing to take those calls in August.
But I'm just saying is that, you know, it's going to take some time on our part, but by August, we should be able to have some direction that for you to take and then to start moving forward.
Okay.
Because this, in reality, this all has to be in place. Everything's got to be set up with what you want. Probably by middle of January at the latest to get any consideration from the Board of Supervisors for the budget.
Okay, sounds good. William also has my contact information too, so you can get a hold of me very quickly.
All right,
great.
Thank
you.
Thank you.
It almost got the county probably got those like phones and the manager.
It must.
Although we're not using them.
Okay, item 7, community leader report, Kern County Sheriff's Office.
Reverend Jane Van Hunt from the Sheriff's Office in Oakland. For the month of May, the East area responded to 1,923 calls for service. 728 of those were in Rosemond. We had a ton of arrests this month. There were 92 arrests in the East area and 36 in Rosemond. There was a homicide arrest made the other night. We had a search and rescue of a 2-year-old. That was successful a couple weeks ago, and there's still other investigations and homicides that have occurred in the past that are still being worked, and we are hoping to get some arrests on those too.
Keep you guys
busy. Very good.
Any questions to the Sheriff's Department?
Are we getting any new officers yet? I know the academy's over.
The academy's over. We've lost some officers right now. All our positions are filled, but some of them are via training. So some experienced officers have left, and we'll be getting new officers to replace them when they're trained.
And those other deputies went to a different department?
No, all the officers have left and went to different units in this department.
Okay.
So how many do we have for Rosemont?
Well, Rosemont is still assigned 7 deputies, 1 senior deputy. We have a new senior deputy who just started last week. TJ Moore, very good guy, learning fast. We have actually 6 deputies that are here in Rosemont. 1 is via training. We have a total of 16 for Rosemont, Mojave, Boron, and Tehachapi Knight.
Do you think your board could draft a letter to the Kern County supervisors? I know they really don't give a damn about us here in Rosemont, but tell them we need at least 20 officers here since we have all these problems.
I think we kind of already did that. We at least told them about it.
It's disgusting. They dump all their garbage here, but they give us no police officer to take care of it. These poor men are worked to death. It's just terrible. This is not civilized.
And I'm sure you guys have all seen the video that we're out on.
I'm glad to see. I didn't know what you guys are doing.
There's a video out. The Sheriff's Department actually put another copy of the same video out. The use of force that occurred at Trailer Park here in Rosemont last week. So. There's also a press release.
I need to quit going to work. Obviously, I need to look at Facebook more.
Yes.
So this is a what happened?
The use of the force video, the deputies actually showed extreme restraint.
Yes, they did.
And the use of force, they're good on restraint. People decide they don't want to follow certain laws, so.
What?
That's my neighborhood.
Animal control call.
I'm pretty much shocked.
Go on to 15th Street.
It actually went to KTLA. And
yep. KTLA. And I've been getting home at dark time, so there ain't no TV.
Well, it's not a surprise to me that Kern County Sheriff's Department had a video like that. You guys have always, in my opinion, they've been the utmost professionals. Great job. Okay, California Highway Patrol.
Officer Stevens from Mojave CHP office. May for Rosemont area, we had 13 DUI arrests, 15 injury collisions, 16 non-injury collisions, 6 hit and run collisions. I don't know if everyone here has heard about our open house June 23rd from noon to 4 p.m. Several things on display there. K9 unit, we'll have tours around our office, rollover simulator, car seat installation clinic, a bunch of our old vehicles that are going to be there that we get some look at. Dispatchers there, senior volunteers, explorer booths, that sort of thing. We have DUI demonstration. DUI drug arrests are on the rise. As we all know, medical marijuana, now recreational marijuana, is a big issue. And it's now the second most substance abused while driving, other than alcohol. If you see something while you're driving, just call 911 and report it, and hopefully we're in a position to take care of it.
How much percentage points up on the DUI non-alcohol drivers? I figured about 7%.
They're still gathering all that information. They added new vehicle code sections this past year to where they can track a little better for a specific, if you're a combination of alcohol and drugs or just drugs. So they're still collecting all that information to get the stats out there.
The gas from Chip still showing?
He is still showing.
I'd like to say kudos for the CHP for the arrest on the hit and run fatality from December. That was good work.
We'll give that all to John because he was part on that.
So the open house is Saturday from when to when?
4 to noon.
Four to noon.
That's a shift. That's one shift.
Yeah. That's the guy answering the questions.
Okay, noon
noon to four?
Champion's jug.
Okay, remember, anybody that shows up from four to noon, let him check.
Jack's going to be banning that one.
All right. Any other questions of our CHP?
Well, yeah, what was your last name again?
Stevens.
Stevens.
Thank you. Okay, Kern County Fire Department. No one here? Kern County Supervisor's Office.
Yay!
Good evening, everyone. Couple of things.
This is Mike, by the way. He didn't say his name.
Michael Clark, yep. I think it's here on the agenda.
Wouldn't have your job, little man. There will, Michael.
Someone's got to do it. So the Public Works, God bless you. The Public Works update here from Rosamond. I just want to get here to a couple of projects that have been addressed or are being addressed by Public Works. The first one is at 35th Street West and Rosamond Boulevard to Orange Street. The pavement crack filling work is complete and the roadway is to be blade sealed. So that is done. At 40th Street West and Rosamond Boulevard to Holiday, the pavement crack filling work is complete and the roadway is still to be blade sealed. And then A Street, 110th Street to 100th Street West, and A Street, the blade seal is complete. So those are three completed projects from Public Works for Rosamond. We have the SB 54 letter that's from Ryan Alsop, our general office administrator, that Greg has. Greg Wood, I sent it to you, and Greg is gonna get it to the board members so that everybody sees kind of what the county's position is legally with the sanctuary city laws and all of that. And one more thing, I was in a meeting here in Rosamond at Rosamond High School last week with the dean of the Antelope Valley College, and there's something exciting that's gonna be taking place here at Rosamond High. And I'll send this flyer also to the board members here so you guys have a copy of this with contact information and also the newspaper if you're interested in getting the contact information for the news. This is what is called a multi-craft core curriculum pre-apprenticeship training program.
What?
Multi-craft.
It's a pre-apprenticeship training program.
Pre-apprenticeship training.
Correct. This is put on by the Antelope Valley College. It is supported by Kern County, Los Angeles County, and Orange County. And it's also supported by the Building and Trade Construction Trade Council and the unions that represent these trades. So it's for construction workers. Basically, it is an 8-week class that includes 166 hours of instruction, including 20 hours of hands-on training, basic mathematics for construction, blueprint reading, plus CPR, first aid, hazmat, and OSHA 10 training. The classes include guest speakers and visits to union training centers and business centers. The requirements, you just basically have to be a U.S. citizen and have a high school diploma or GED, and it's free. The whole program is free. Once you complete the program, you get a license and you get immediate work through one of these construction companies for anywhere from 6 to 12 months, paid at a prevailing wage. And then once you finish your probation there, membership in a lot of these unions as well, these
union
trade
companies
unions.
Are actually bringing back apprenticeship programs?
Yes.
Yeah.
Wow. It's huge. How many slots?
There are up to 30 students that will be accepted in this next class, which will be at Rosamond High School starting August 20th.
Is there an application they have to fill? How does that go?
Yeah, you're going to want to contact the Antelope Valley College because they're kind of the education center that's taking the grant money from the state of California. I'll give you a couple of phone numbers if you want them, and then I'll send you guys this form with all the details on it. You could contact either, I won't even give you the name, it's hard to pronounce here, but the phone number is 66...
What's the name?
Suge Galademas.
Yeah, that one.
Yeah, 661-476...
Went to school.
4232. If Suge's here, I'm sorry I butchered your name.
What was the number again? we're still hanging up on the...
Just spell it out. 661-476-4232, and I will email this to whoever wants a copy.
Yes, please.
Also, you can contact the Antelope Valley College admissions office at 661-722-6300, or go to their website at www.avc.edu, and they have all this information. I was there in a meeting with all of these the Goodwills involved from Los Angeles, construction trade organizations from Los Angeles were there, the dean of the Antelope Valley College was there, the assistant principal of Rosamond High School was there. There's a lot of movers and shakers that are bringing these jobs to the Antelope Valley.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
That's all I've got.
Okay, Mike, I have a question for you. About a year ago, we were given a presentation that we had been awarded a grant to have asphalt walkways put in along Rosen Boulevard, I believe from the United Street Apartments to Sierra Highway, I believe, somewhere in that area. And then there was supposed to be some coming down 20th Street here as well. But we've heard nothing on that since then, and I was just kind of wondering, you know, is it still, we still have a green light for that, or is it is something getting hung up somewhere?
When was the grant approved?
2016, I believe.
Yeah, it's like 2016. It was, we were approved, and they were supposed to start within about the next 12 months, and we haven't heard a word about it since. And
but there was a shift change with you guys.
So if you could look into that and kind of let us know, give us a status, that would be great.
So asphalt walkways, Rosamond Boulevard and 20th West, you said?
Right, I believe it was...
United, which would be 10th.
Yeah, but it was supposed to go along Rosamond Boulevard, and it was just going to be about a 6 foot wide path of asphalt just laid down so some people had something to walk on, their wheelchairs, their scooters, walkers, things like that.
Boron has a similar, it's like a bike path or a pedestrian path that was approved, I think around the same time in 2016. It's going to, they're going to begin construction in Boron on this in 2019, and it's probably going to be completed by 2020, so it might be that same sort of
time
frame.
I'm just saying, we've heard them, you know, they were here, it was a great presentation, they said they had applied for the grant. It was a couple of months after that meeting, we got word that Rosamond was approved for the grant,
but
then we haven't heard anything since.
Okay, I'll look into it, try and get some information.
Yeah, so someone on the 20th, and so someone on the Rosamond
Boulevard.
Right, any other questions of our Kern County Supervisor's Office?
Yeah, Mike, my name is Wade Hatcher, I talked to you a while ago. I'm a little put out with the supervisor, and I'm more put out with your legal staff. I assume that being a taxpayer, I pay them to help me and not work with the state of California. And I know you got nothing to do with that. But next time you talk to legal staff, explain to them that their wages are being paid for by people who work for, or live in the county that don't have anything to do with the state as far as kissing the governor's ass. There's something wrong with that man. It really is. But it just, it perturbs me that I'm paying somebody to do somebody else's
public,
work.
Public comment?
Yeah. It really is.
So,
what, is that a question? So do you have any other questions?
No, I just wanted to do a little bit of back on.
Well, let's move on then. Thank you, Mike. Send them in Tom Lackey's office. Anybody here this evening? Rosen Community Watch.
Yes, last June the 2nd, we helped out with the Girl Scouts.
Scout cleanup over on 55th and Holiday. We had over 20 volunteers that picked up over 20 bags of trash, along with numerous other items. We also have removed the graffiti from the block wall in front of the catch basin over on Gordon Street. And as we were doing that, we found major damage to the block wall in the back, along with additional graffiti. I do have some pictures for Michael. I'll be passing those on to you. Our next cleanup is going to be the third Saturday in July, which will be the 21st. Location and time are still to be determined as we see the weather.
We had talked the last time, I believe it was the last meeting, about the, what is that store we talked about?
A&T Market.
That one.
Nobody's gotten a hold of it.
Have you noticed that there's a lot more on there? A lot.
Yeah, the thing is that being a wire fence, and if they don't want it painted, we can't paint it. Another option they have is to turn those slats around, but that's...
That's just giving them a fresh slate.
We've got green paint. If they want to change the fence green, they just have to call us.
Here's the deal on that. We are authorized by the county, by Kern County, to go out and do graffiti for Roseland. By code from Kern County, we are not allowed to just go out and paint. If we cannot get authorization from a homeowner or a business to paint their wall, we are not allowed to touch it. If we go and paint it, we are illegally doing something wrong, and we're not going to do that.
No, I totally get that. I just don't see why a business person would want to have that on their business.
They just don't. You know what? We deal with it all the time, and, you know, it's the same thing with that block wall over there at the Roseman Gateway Apartments. We are actually not allowed to paint that wall because it's private property. But county does not want that graffiti there, so they authorize us to go ahead and paint it. We are not authorized to go out there and paint it on our own because of all the morons who live in the back property who do the graffiti carry guns. And those gang members that actually go out there and do it carry guns. We are not allowed to carry guns. Now, this is under Kern County and under Highway Patrol. We are not allowed to go out there. If we go out there and paint, we have to set up a date with law enforcement to be out there with us to paint that wall.
Right, and we would want you to be safe.
And we have to, because we have younger people to go out there with us. Me personally, I don't care if I go out there on my own and do it. I'll deal with these morons myself. But we cannot do it under law enforcement. They have to be there when we paint that wall because of all the people in the back.
On the A&T Market, it's a chain link fence. If they don't want it painted green, we can't. The slats are green. We can paint the whole thing green if they want. But they don't want it painted. They want it taken off piece by piece with the graffiti remover. We're not capable of doing that. But they can either, if they call us, we'll paint the whole fence green, or they can turn the slats around. It's a really simple fix, but they have to give us permission to do it.
All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, any other color we have with a spray can of paint? One with a roll of cover paint.
All right, any other questions for Community Watch?
Quickly, you had mentioned a few weeks ago about the gas station derelict over on the corner of Roseland Boulevard and Sarah Highway. The old Jacob Doyle. Somebody is cleaning that up. I wonder if they're going to turn that into a pot shop.
I don't know about a pot shop, but they are painting it. I just drove by it.
I think Roseland needs more pot shops. Hell, we don't have one now.
Okay, moving on.
Within the last month, the Roseland Community Service District Board of Directors has voted to give back Williford Park to the County of Kern. Our general manager signed a grant deed, or quick claim deed, back to the county. That's step one. Number two, step three, Kern County rejected the quick claim deed, so they don't want the park back. So Tuesday night we voted to get completely out of the parks business. So Roseland no longer has parks. Roseland Community Service District no longer has the purpose of the power to handle parks and recreation anymore. And step five would be then there is a clause in the quick claim deed, but they gave us the parks and said if we put it up for sale, it automatically reverts to the county. So I don't know if that's going to happen anytime soon or not.
but be interested to see how that plays out. Hopefully,
how do you sell a park?
Well, I don't know. You put a bid in there, Donna. Put a closed bid in there saying, I'm going to pay a dollar for the park. Actually, once it's offered for sale, it doesn't have to sell it. Once it's offered for sale, the county gets it back automatically, according to the paperwork. I don't know how it automatically works.
That's a pretty major question to ask.
Yeah, but...
what's the mechanism here?
So hopefully, Mike's made sure that they put a budget in their budget to make sure they have enough money to pick up the Willowford Park and carry it beyond whatever the CSA pays in from the home residents in the West Park area.
Mike has no say in the budget whatsoever.
Mike has all the say in the budget. In fact, Mike is making sure that he's put in some money for the lights over there at the Glendale Park, right?
Yeah.
Has the budget been approved by Kern County Board of Supervisors yet?
The budget for 2019?
2018-2019, yeah.
I think it's already agreed upon. I don't know if it's finalized yet or not.
But you see, they vote, like, all public entities, school board, our board of supervisors, any public entity has to have a preliminary budget voted on before July 1st and submit. And then in August, they do a final budget approval. So that would be the time. Now's the time to talk to Mike and say, hey, Mike, add that $100,000 we need in there to put in those streetlights over Glendower Park. Of course, one of the biggest issues always has been is the bathroom over there. Costs are, you can do a lot more with volunteers rather than have the county do it. So if you figure out a way to do it, it'd be a lot less. I know that the initial lights that were put up at the Frozen Little League was all done by volunteers. It wasn't done with any help from the county. They put it up themselves.
I received a text that about 8 years ago, I caught the estimate to put lights on the junior field was about $200,000.
Yeah. But you might go to find
so now it's about $3-4.
That's about $2.
We've talked, again, this is just our first step, so we're in very, very, first steps of thinking about this. It's always been a goal of ours as a league, but we've thought of ideas of even reaching out to some of the solar companies, having them put out a antenna out there and kind of funding it, doing solar lights and those types of things. So again, this is all in talks. This is why I'm here. I'd be more than happy to talk to you a little bit more into where we need to go. Any one of you, if you want to stay after and talk.
And of course, Jack Miller of the Rosen Chamber of Commerce is the main sponsor of the Bilby Event Center, where solar companies would. They're west of town, so he has connections. He can find.
Oh, we're gonna be talking.
But you did bring up a good point. The bathrooms over there definitely need some tender loving care. So.
And Mike's got that in his report
yes.
as well.
I will pass it up the chain of command.
He's gonna make it happen. Mike makes it happen.
No
pressure.
Budget.
No. I have a question.
Travis came over.
I have a question regarding Graywater Olive. Property owners, are they obligated to do something with that water, or are they allowed just to dump it on the street?
That Graywater, that's a good question for the county. But he can answer your Graywater questions, because if you dump it on the street, it's not our obligation so much.
What's a gray zone?
Gray water is not allowed to be dumped on any public right-of-way or thoroughfare or anywhere the public goes. Gray water has to be disposed of properly down a sewer into a sanitary sewer system or to a septic system.
Well, that's changing somewhat. In the Bay, if with the new houses that come online, you can set up your own gray water system, which essentially turns out you pay.
But you're not putting it into the street.
You don't put it in the street. Right. You pay your own system, and you can put it on your plants and things like that. But that's new stuff, and that's not anything anybody has now. But I don't think one of the things we did talk about. We did pass a budget here Tuesday, an $8.4 million budget for the Rosa Community Service District, including water and sewer, street lighting, graffiti abatement, with $0 for parks. Although we're going to take most of our ad valorem money. We do have about $270,000 out of more money every year, and we've started to build up a general fund that'll cross over the four different, or the five different areas, so we can spend that where we want to.
Kind of a rainy day.
In the future, no, in a general fund. So that, right now, community service doesn't have the ability to do parks if we don't have any money. The only place we were getting money is from the ad valorem money, it's kind of a general fund money. And if we don't have parks and recreation anymore, we still have to pay off the $2 million debt we owe from the parks to the water district, which sponsored the building of the United Street Park and some other things down the line. That's got to be paid back. But other things that happened, for example, we purchased 200 acres over in LA County, about 220 Street West. We've leased that back to a solar company, and we're going to be getting an income stream from that. That'll go into the general fund. And as those types of things happen, we'll have a little bit of money to work with to see what we can get done down the line. But it's not a whole lot, but it's something. But ad valorem money is actually something we're talking about down the line. But that's what the budget is. For example, we use the ad valorem money to pay the $6,500 or so a year we spend on graffiti abatement, in addition to a great good work that Paul and Gail do with moving graffiti abatement. It's actually in our charter to do that since 1998. And again, the voters gave us the funding for that, but fortunately, unlike parks, it doesn't cost a lot to buy paint and spray over and do those types of things. But then the last thing you mentioned, gray water is one thing. We do have a $12 million tertiary water plant over there that for years we had to let sit idle because we have no way of redistributing the water, number one. And number two, the cost of that water is too expensive for anybody to put the system in and use it. Well, it turns out the state is interested in helping us to recycle water. It's actually in the Constitution of the state, Article 20. You're supposed to make beneficial use of water if you can. Right now, our sewer water goes out, and the secondary water just kind of goes out and sits in ponds and evaporates. Well, evaporated water doesn't really help anybody. So what we're going to do, we're going to take that $12 million facility. We're not going to use the ultraviolet anymore. We're going to put a little... a basin to catch the water and treat it so that the nitrates come out. It'll come out as secondary water, and apparently below the caliche layer that we have out there, we went about 7 acres south of where we're at now, on the south by Patterson Road. We're going to take a few acres of that and make it into a water bank. Take the caliche top off, there's supposed to be a lot of sand underneath that, and the water will go down into the soil again, and we'll recharge the area with more water. Now the cool thing about the way that works, we'll get credit for that as far as the adjudication goes. To the tune, we're putting as much as 1,100 acre feet of water in there a year. We get about 40% of that back, plus I guess some carryovers that we don't have to buy from AVAC. So it's for the as the ramp down comes up, we'll have this other water coming in. And the better thing about that too is when we want to pull that water out, we can still pull it out of well 8 over there by 50th Street West and Gaskell. And the fresh water, the good water is, even though the water's going in way over there on almost the Edwards Air Force Base, because it's all the same lake underground, the way the adjudication treats it, we can still pull it out over here and use it there. We don't have to switch special lines to take the water and just put it in over there. Credit for it. So
the state health department has already given the green light on doing direct injection of secondary water?
No, it's not direct injection. It's going to be a water bank.
It's
going to go through the sand. It'll definitely go through the sand.
Still releasing it on top.
It'll release on top and go down. And it's the Lahontan region that actually gave the green light. And and the other thing you may not know, Proposition 1 in 2014 was passed so that we can actually do more water projects, deepen dams. I think they're going to deepen another deep in Shasta, but I think that's a federal project. But some other dams to increase our ability to hold water. There's a bunch of great projects up and down the state. North of Sacramento is the Sykes Reservoir, south of Sacramento is Temperance Flats Reservoir. Not one of those projects has been approved. The bureaucracy's kind of held it up. But the good news is that there is one project they're really interested in. Those reservoirs, huge reservoirs, they have evaporation, right? What kind of project do we know here in the Alamo Valley that doesn't have any evaporation, very little?
Aquifer.
It's the water bank. So the semi-tropic water bank, the one that Rosen Community Service District is invested in, has another water bank they set up called the Willow Springs Water Bank. And they're actually going to pay for a turnout to come from the California Aqueduct. so they can take the water over. And they're number one on the list of Prop 1 projects in the state right now. Because once it gets in the ground, there's no evaporation. It just goes in the ground. There's a 10%, you know,
loss
figured into all that. But it that's how much credit you get for when you put it in the ground. So that's the good news. The other part about the water banks, Allen Valley East Kern has really taken an aggressive approach to making sure they bank water. That's the good news. They're part of the 28 agencies that are state water project users of the California Aqueduct. But our semi-tropic didn't get a drop of that excess water that was coming down, all the surplus water, because AVEC took it all. So now if we get our own turnout, we can get our own water run over there in the good years and start banking some water in that bank. And that'll satisfy part of what we need as far as water stores through the years here, so we have that in the dry years as well.
One final question. Is the state government going to be funding you guys for water police?
No. No.
Is
there an academy?
Well, highway patrol's going to job pretty soon.
There's folks that have cranked their sprinkler systems up.
If you see a problem, talk to your neighbor or even say, hey, you know, you might be using a little excess water. And if that's still a problem, I don't want to tell the RCSD, but I just have to know. Somebody over there will come look at that. You want them to do that, and maybe they'll crank it back down. But you want to use common sense. They did mention, for example, the state. I was up at the water law conference here last week, and the State Department of Water Resources had like seven things, and they said some of the basic no-brainers are: if you get a quarter inch of rain or more, don't water within 48 hours of that. You know, you don't need to. You're gonna wash your car. Don't leave the hose running. Put a nozzle on it. So you're running with, that hard is that to do? But so they had some basic things that weren't not that hard to do, and you can think them through on your own. And we have to make an ordinance to help remind you. I suppose we could do that too. But the water, as far as having water police, we only have 14 employees. We're not going
to. I'm just wondering how they expect you guys to keep yourselves within that mandated limit that the governor and the legislature has come up with.
Right now, there is no mandated limit because the drought's over, but it always can come back. There's no question about that. And you always want to. Article 20 of the state constitution says basically you're supposed to make beneficial use of all the water you can, including stormwater, something that the county takes care of at this point. But you mentioned that the walls are being repeated over in a catch basin. Catch basins belong. Again, to the county. One of the things that needs to be done, though, I talked to the mosquito abatement person from AB, comes up to the county line there, in LA County, Allen Valley Mosquito Abatement District. She said, she did last year, she wouldn't get much cooperation from the county in our catch basins here in Rosemont. So that's one area we can improve in. It's one area the RCSD actually has some power in. That's another area, though, that contrary to the Constitution, some people are talking about getting out of that as well. Why, but in the meantime, one area that the county should be addressing is making sure that they're working with the Allen Valley Mosquito Abatement District and making sure that if there is what they call dry weather overrun, that it's not catching there and staying there, and mosquitoes are breeding in the nice warm summer months. So anyway, is there any other questions about what's going on with the Rosemont Community Services District?
I have a question. I missed the meeting the other day. My sister's on well water, and she had a letter stating there was a meeting about people well water wells. That you guys are going to start charging a fee.
If you're a farmer,
okay,
that's possible. If you're
residents.
All farmers are supposed to have meters on their wells as of December last year, as part of the adjudication. As far as a residence, and she's already got a well.
Yeah.
I doubt if there's going to be. That's not us though. That'll be for the water master. Check with Allen Valley East Kern.
Okay.
Check with Patty Rose over there. She grew up over here on Peter Pat. Just ask her what's going on, and she'll tell you who you need to contact about that type of thing. But we're not going to meter wells. The Rosa Community Service District is not going to.
Okay. That's what I want.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, my question to you all is what. He was referring to was SB 606 and AB 1668, which was two laws the governor just signed, and that is mandating that requires cities, water districts, and large agricultural water districts to set strict annual water budgets. Essentially, what they're going to do is they're setting a limit of 55 gallons per person in a household for indoor water use, and that what they're not going to monitor each home. They're going to monitor the water use of the RCSD, and you guys have gotten to develop a permanent water restriction plan, and that if you are not in compliance with it, that you can be charged up to $1,000 a day for each day that you're not in compliance. That's what the law that the governor just signed just a few weeks ago.
I hadn't heard that law, and it's something that's come across our board of directors to look at as far as
it's very new all of it.
It's new, but it's something that's coming your way, and
look at having lawyers.
Well, all I know is we didn't need a water police. As you know, that when we had the cutbacks, Rosa exceeded the amount of the reduction we were supposed to have. We were supposed to have 25%, I think we had 30% reduction in our water. The residents did very well of meeting that. So as far as doing that, I don't think, as long as they're not making it individual, I think Rosamond will have no problem with that. We are an adjudicated basin now, so unlike other areas, they have to do with what is known as SGMA, State Groundwater Management Act. They have to do something similar to what we're doing already with our Antelope Valley groundwater. But since we're already adjudicated, we already have the mandate to ramp down our use, and we need to find other water sources. So if we want to keep our water bill down overall as a community, we're going to have to take steps to make sure that we don't overuse our water, number one, and we need to take steps to find more water as well.
Well, the adjudication only refers to the pumping of groundwater, and surface water, like you said, you're going to have to go out and purchase it. Community's not going to make it on 450 acre feet of groundwater that you need to pump out of the ground.
Right.
Have to go out and purchase it way back or whatever. But what this law is stating, and it's a great concern to me, and should be a concern to everybody, is that where before, like you stated, the state would come back and say each agency has to cut their water use from 20% from what they used in any given year that the state had to pick. What they're doing now is that they are saying you are going to limit the amount of water that your district uses on a daily basis, and you're going to have to come up with a plan to say that based upon every household, let's say you have a household that has four people in per house, so for every connection you have, that's going to be 220 gallons of indoor use that you're allowed. So you're going to have to, according to what it looks like on this, you're going to prepare some kind of an ordinance saying that you're going to restrict your water use district-wide to this amount of water, you know, per year or per day or whatever, and that if you don't comply with that, then the state can come back and fine. And this is statewide.
So well, I wouldn't overthink it because, in general, as you probably know, Rosamond, we don't use much water at all as compared, for example, Quartz Hill. We don't have huge lawns. We don't have a lot of water usage. We just don't. And if you compare it to other communities, if they start taking that approach, you have an equal protection argument from my perspective as an attorney. You can't penalize one community differently than treat one community different than another community. You got to understand where the state's coming from on that. If they're stepping out of line with respect to how they're doing that, I don't see the state wanting to be the bad guys either. So we'll see how that shakes out, and we'll see what kind of ordinance we need. I might imagine that we belong to the AQUA, as you know, the Association of California Water Associations, and as well as the Special Districts Association. So imagine we'll come up with some sort of model thing we can work from to make it work to satisfy the state requirements in a neutral type of way, because if they put it more specific, then they run the risk of an equal protection argument, saying we're going to punish the person for having too many people in their house, but they can't do that. Are you going to punish people for having a longer shower than somebody else? That you still can't do that. You have to have some reason that goes along with it. And I think the smarter people than me have to think of a model for us to follow, and we'll be able to tweak that. So we'll see.
It's in the summertime. That's my cooler in one bath. That's my 55 gallons. That makes no sense. I can't afford an air conditioner, so I use a swamp filter. Is the state going to give me an air conditioner?
This isn't a deal. It's what the war drums are beating about this.
If it happens that fast, usually when they pass legislation and they have like an implementation date, 6 months or a year down the line, it's not an emergency matter at this point. So we'll see if we have something. And as you know, the Aqua Conference, and I would expect to have something by at the end of the Aqua Conference in December would make sense.
We could all stop taking Basil in Sacramento.
Now.
there was talk of a water tax. I think, I don't know if you heard about that, but I think that's going to be shot down. 80%. They're going to say it's only a dollar, but it's actually going to be about $20 to $30 per person per month. I think for water was with the water tax, and that's what the Democrats in the legislature came up with. That we should start taxing water. And Tim Quinn from the from Aqua, our director there, said, "Look, do you really need to reinvent the taxing system? Because it's going to be a regressive tax anyway. You tax everybody for a connection. That means rich and poor alike can be paying $20 to $30 a month on a water connection. And for what reason? Because you want to help disadvantaged water districts. Well, we just passed a bond. I know in here 2 weeks ago on June 5th or 6th that takes care of fixing a lot of those water problems already. That's the way to do it. Not pass a water tax, but
yeah, I think what they're doing, Olaf, is I think they're trying to find a way to pay for the massive infrastructure repair bill up at the levees and things like that.
Up north of Oregon.
Well, the twin tunnels, the LA Department of Water and Power, and what's their sister company called? Metro LA Metro. They've agreed to pay for 80%, I think, or 60% of the tunnels already. So it's not coming out of the state's pocket; it's coming out of their pocket, but they provide water to 19 million users in the state of California. That's over half the people of California. So it makes sense for them to pay 60% of the bill.
Sure.
But they're stepping up to make sure that happens. So I don't think that's not the issue. I think that some people are just getting a little nuts up there, so we used to pay.
No, not the water tunnel for the damage.
There's so much infrastructure disrepair that it's been decades.
As far as the dams and stuff like that, the federal government passed Dianne Feinstein got together with Kevin McCarthy, which is like oil and vinegar, except when it comes to water, and they actually put something together. The federal government's going to pay for 25% of all those repairs and things like that, deepening dams. And the one speaker we had, he said, back in the day when 73, 74, when Nixon was president and he was on kind of hot water, he vetoed their bill, and they overrode it. 75% of everything was that infrastructure they put in back then was paid for by grants from the federal government. Well, now that's 1970 stuff is now crumbling infrastructure. The crumbling infrastructure is what they're going to spend that money on with the grant money for the feds. Going to be 25. Imagine the state will have to put 25, and then us, the water users, probably have to come with the other 50. But we'll figure it out. All right.
Any other questions of RCST?
No.
Thank you, Olaf.
You're welcome.
Okay, Roseland Foundation, your report, Roseland Chamber of Commerce.
All right, we had our outgoing president and vice president was next day's meeting. So the infamous Donna Morris was the chair today. She was up there going, wah, wah, wah,
the
wah,
joke
wah,
of the
wah,
meeting.
Wah, wah, wah.
Charlie Brown's teacher.
But anyhow, things on the horizon, September Fest and Armed Forces Day Parade, September 22nd, excuse me. I'm looking at the date. Today is 21st. Anyhow, our theme this year is going to be very different. It is not every GI is a Joe. So this year's focus is going to be women in the military. So we'll be out looking for distinguished military women, and that'll be our focus this year.
Distinguished.
I'm sorry?
Distinguished, right?
I didn't hear it.
Distinguished.
Distinguished, is that right?
Distinguished.
Yeah, well,
it sounded like extinguished.
No, it didn't. Sorry, it's been one of those days. Yeah, it really is water, I swear. Must have been the nap, I don't know. But, we'll fill you in as things move closer to that. Last month, meeting, we had the elections, everybody knows that. And, since then, we have elected positions. So, new positions are, Gene Melcher is the new VP, Vice President. Albert Gatton here, raise your hand, Albert, is our new treasurer. And I'm the new president-elect as of July 1st. Everybody's position will take over. The outgoing board will be that's no longer with us. Staying with us is Don Morris. And just for the record, with our map, she said she didn't have enough work to do on our map, so she volunteered for every position she could and project in the chamber.
Move along with your talk.
Okay. I just want to make sure that the secretary writes that down. And then we have Jed Strange. He's still a director as well. So, for the next year, Jed and I will still be members, and then we can vote for election next year. So, that's really about it. The event center's coming along. I think it's just about wrapped up for the first phase almost. They're putting some pavers out there. And anybody have any questions for the chamber? Nope, thank you.
All right, thank you. Good evening. Hey, Rosen Youth Football and Cheer, anybody here in today? Mm-hmm. Southern Korean Unified School District? Anyone?
We saw that they're seeking a new superintendent. The old one is finishing up June 30th this year. And other than that, I think you pretty much know what's going on.
Yeah.
Okay.
I was at the meeting last night. Leanne Hargis is going to be taking over as interim superintendent while the board searches for a new one. Wish her the best of luck. I think she'll do a fine job. And they seated a new board member to take Vinnie Otis's place. And that was a gentleman by the name of David Gregg. So wish him the best of luck. And that's all I have to report.
We also had a resignation, so let me step a position.
Well, until it's official, you can't really say anything publicly.
Greg, they did see. Oh. Him on the board?
David Gregg?
David Gregg?
Yes, they see him.
Okay, because I heard they were going to interview all the applicants that applied.
Yeah, well, they did, and they seated him yesterday.
Okay.
And so anyhow, that's all that I have to officially report on the school board meeting. And with that, any other questions about Southern Korean Unified? All right, Antelope Valley Citizens for Responsible Use of Water. Edwards Air Force Base. And under others, we'll get Mr. Albert to stand there because I know he can't go to a meeting without giving his presentation.
All right. Well, thank you for coming to the meeting. Just a quick real estate update for everybody. Last month, we had 25 home sales with an average sales price of $241,116. It's actually down 5.1% from the month previous. The reason for that, it appears that the average size home that sold went down. The month before, we were at 1,761 square feet as an average. Last month, we were at 1,498, so quite a good size drop. It was down 14.92% on the size. The price didn't go further down because price per square foot actually rose quite a bit. Price per square foot last month was at $164.48 per square foot. That was a 12.66% increase from the month before. Right now, as of this afternoon, we have 57 active homes for sale and 57 homes that are currently pending that are in escrow. So the market's still moving pretty quick. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to help out.
What was that square footage price again?
The average square footage or the price per square foot?
Price per square foot.
Was $164.48.
$164.48.
Okay. Calculating the house there?
Of course I am.
So, yeah, the average price is going up. And again, a lot of that has to do with the size homes. The larger the home size is, generally the price per square foot will go down a little bit because it's more expensive to build smaller homes than it is larger homes overall.
All right. Community announcements. Bona Fide representatives, community service organizations, and clubs are invited to announce upcoming events open to the public. Please limit your presentations to no more than 3 minutes.
Actually, I've got one. Over on B Street, between Woodland Boulevard and that street is to the south, is a red building. I mentioned this before. It's a multi-use facility owned by Four Square International. And the church that I go to, St. Andrew's Anglican, is one of the users. It's also where they have the food giveaway. On Thursdays, I think it is, isn't it? Dave, we lost Dave.
Yes.
Someone's going to have to pay the ransom, I guess, and get Dave back. But,
nature calls.
And then on Sunday afternoons. So they're in the middle right now of painting that facility inside now, doing new electrical repair and other work that needs to be done, so it's much more presentable. But the plan is for a free community breakfast, sponsored by the congregation there, July 21st, God willing. We'll firm that up as we go, because we want to make sure that all that work is completed before we proceed with that. But you might want to watch that. The July 21st.
Very good. Any other community announcements? All right, item 9, public comment period. Any member of the public may address the council regarding any matter of concern to relevant residents. This need not be related to any items on the agenda. However, law prohibits the council from taking action on matters not on the agenda. Please limit your presentations to 3 minutes. So at this point, I'll open the floor up to public comments. Yes, Paul.
Yeah, last month I was here at the meeting with you guys, and I addressed a very concerned issue with accessibility across Roseland Boulevard. You guys said you guys would put it in your agenda. Dennis Schopper said he was going to put it in the agenda. It's not on the agenda.
Well, I think that
you said it last month. But anyways, I think that's a very major concern that I have. The other thing is I have gone around this community. I work all day long. I get off of work and I drive around this community and look at a lot of things to address this board. One, we talked about some of the catch basins. A lot of these catch basins, the block walls are torn down. There's a lot of carts that are going in inside the catch basins. A lot of the catch basins have water inside of it. And trash and so forth, graffiti and so forth on that. Now, you guys have on your agenda here, public health and community welfare committee. That's something that you guys should be looking into. And you guys do, whether you work or not, because I do it, and I work 14 hours, 13 hours, 10 hour days. And I go out and I look at a lot of this stuff on my own personal time. And I take pictures, which Mike, you will actually be getting these pictures here pretty quick. Okay. You have a lot of children out in the West Park area. You have a couple of catch basins out there that the fences are down. Easy accessibility for kids to walk into these catch basins, and you have water inside these catch basins, which some kids are going to go walk in there and sink and never get out, and nobody's ever going to find that kid. Right over here on the east side of the tracks, quite a few basins. You have a basin right here, right across the street, which you have a lot of debris and so forth inside these basins. I think this board needs to start stepping up and start going out and looking at a lot of things that are wrong in this community, other than myself just going in and bringing it up to your guys' attention. You have Public Works Committee, which is Bill Parkman. You do an awesome job looking at a lot of stuff. We have talked many times, a lot of concerns in this community. You have Public Relations Committee and so forth. I think this board needs to go out and start looking at a lot of things instead of the community actually coming in here and bringing it to your attention. You guys have lived here for a lot of years, as well as I have lived here for many years. As much as I, like I said, as much as I go out and work and do stuff in this community, I have not really seen this board actually take action to go out and look for things that are wrong. Just like 15th Street, having accessibility. You have from Roseman Boulevard, CHP is going to have an issue when that track or a train derailment happens on Roseman Boulevard. They have 5 miles to go north of Roseman Boulevard over to Sauk. That's 5 miles. There's no accessibility to come back over to Roseman Boulevard. You have 2 miles to get over to Patterson. You have accessibility to get across the tracks, but you have no accessibility to come all the way back over to Roseman Boulevard unless you go all the way down to Challenger, which is basically 10 feet. I have driven that road multiple times, and I know several of Jack has driven that road. Fire truck is never going to make it across that road. It's much equipment that fire truck has. Plus, it holds over 500, 600 gallons on that truck of water. It will never make it across that road. If there's a fire and that train derails, CHP has to get onto Edwards Air Force Base. They're going to have to go all the way around to Avenue E, all the way up to the South Gate, or get back on the freeway and go over to North Gate. I think between this board, county, really look at this issue, because it's going to happen one day, and this town is going to be inaccessible to the east track.
You know, Paul, you're
go ahead, Mike's going to respond.
Can I answer that?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead, Mike.
Yeah, I did, thank you, Paul, for all you're doing. I did follow up with Supervisor Scrivener on this exact item issue that you brought up last month, and then Bill also did me a favor of typing it out and giving me an aerial picture of it and a blow up picture so that I have something actually so we could take it to the county and show them exactly what we're looking at here, because I agree that it is something that needs to be addressed. John Antonaris, who you guys all know, said that if you or anyone else wants to volunteer, as you mentioned to me that you do grading and you've done grading work and things like that, to where the county's not having to pay for the grading and the paving and in other words to take over the road if it's a dirt road that's not being maintained right now by the county, and we could find volunteers with the equipment and the time and the knowledge to scrape it and move the dirt and make it accessible. That is a win-win, and that's something that's a short-term fix that Zach would be grateful for while we're working toward more of a long-term plan on this. But it's not being ignored. What you're saying is not being ignored.
No, I think what basically what I'm pointing at is I think it's not to we as or them as the RMAC or continue giving it to you to do it. I think you guys need to put up a portfolio and go out and take these pictures and put a packet together and present it to the county.
Yep.
That's just your job. You're the representative of the county.
How many of us do
both? That we have this RMAC as a representative of this community should do their job and go out and take these pictures of that road and put a whole packet together, just like a contract, just like anything else. So what I do on a daily basis on my job, I got to go out and take pictures, submit everything that as an as-built or an RFI, which is a request for information. What do we do for this packet? Put it together and submit that whole thing.
The more information we have, the easier it is to get it to the right department.
Okay.
Right.
This is public comment, and we're getting into a full-blown discussion here.
No, I'm just saying, we
understand what you're saying, and Paul, this board has made many attempts and requests and written letters to the Board of Supervisors. The funding just isn't there. And that's, they don't have the money. I mean, I would love to see a road, graded and maintained from Patterson to Roseman Boulevard.
Mike, what's the name of the organization that funds the roads?
Okay.
Kern County.
The roads department, I believe.
No, no, the Kern Economic, what's it called, the Kern...
KernCog?
KernCog.
KernCog, yes.
So maybe we can get one of the RMAC members to attend as a representative of KernCog. And I know that 4 years ago, we put in a whole list of projects, and one Mr. Parkman is very clear on that we'd like to see Don Road paved between Sierra Highway and the 14 freeways, that kind of brainer. And did that ever make it on the list? Where is it on the list now? Could you report back on that? Or do you know?
If you guys want me to follow up on that?
It would be good to find out if it is still on the list. I think it has probably fallen off, and we're getting ready to put it back in there again, because what has happened with Dawn Road there, because it is a dead end, it turns into a trash pile. Mm-hmm. And if we have the ability for commuter traffic to travel a little bit around through that area, it might calm that down some.
Okay, what we'll do is we can put this on the next agenda. Paul, thank you for your input. And any other public comments?
I have an update on the cannabis situation. I'm Tim from Diamond Flagia. County is now involved. The initiative we passed, we did turn in on time for the November ballot. On Monday, June 11th, we had a meeting with the county. Apparently, the county has on the agenda to legalize medical cannabis as well. This is what we talked about on June 11th. It's under the Standing Committee on Health and Social Services. It is ran by Maggard and Gleason. We discussed permitting medical cannabis retail operations, and the presenter was Lorelei Oviatt. They did a presentation of current statewide management of medical cannabis retail operations. They discussed potential ordinance, and there's going to be continued discussion, and it's based on a limited number of retail stores countywide, medical only, specific locations, and no growing. Restriction discussions on the setbacks, zone districts, and licensing types were discussed. Existing legal non-conforming medical retail operation statuses were discussed, and they had public comment. We know that there are 32 open countywide, 18 in planning phase, one awaiting final inspection for California licensing, and two under review. Things that were discussed is the county would like to restrict it before it goes to a vote down to 10 collectives countywide with no cultivation. Cultivation, they're guessing, will be provided through California City. They're in the very early but quick-moving stages of a medical cannabis ordinance. My guess is they're trying to move for an ordinance before it goes to a vote in November. In November, the ordinance on the ballot would give an additional 7.5% tax. It would allow the 34 current collectives to be safe, and it would open up more industry, according to Prop 64. So those are the two things in discussion right now as far as cannabis in Kern County. So there will not be a complete ban on cannabis at all now. That's all I have.
Just a quick question.
Yes.
You qualified an initiative to go on the ballot, though.
Yes, we did. So
it has to pass for that to happen, is that right?
Yeah, so now there's a voter initiative, and now there's the county wanting to do their own proposed initiative.
So there might be two initiatives on the ballot in November.
Yeah, theirs might be one that gets voted on at the supervisor level versus ours, which would be at the voter level. So now it's kind of a race to November to find out what our legalization plan is going to be.
Okay. I don't know if it's the right spot, but I forgot to mention earlier. If possible, in August, we'd like to get on the agenda on some new projects coming up with
office next year with the Chamber of Commerce that we'd like to do a presentation on. And it'd take us a couple months to get everything worked out and stuff. Kent, Business Development Center, Kent, remote viewing location to the county. We got some exciting stuff coming up that I want to talk about in August. And we'll have all the details worked out later.
Any other public comments?
I have one. I don't know if anyone noticed today, but OHS now accepts EBT. Is that not illegal to be able to purchase marijuana with your EBT card?
Who accepts it?
OHS. They put a sign up.
Yeah, it's plastered right on the side of the building.
Isn't it edible?
Sure it is.
I will turn the corner right now. Lunch!
No, it's not.
Except the sign up.
Unless they got groceries in there as well.
Well, it's probably not.
People have lunch with guys.
Okay. Okay, any other public comments? All right. Then we will move on to our next item. Business meeting, standing committee reports, planning committee.
The only thing is the thing that we were just talking about just a minute ago. We're taking a look at this thing with Edwards Air Force Base and the Rosemont Boulevard and Sierra Highway. I talked a little bit with Mike before the meeting about this. There's not a simple solution to this. And I think actually we ought to figure out some way of getting the federal government involved in it too, because they would be one of the beneficiaries of that road so that they can get their people in and up, in and off the base.
Another thing too that I think we ought to talk to and that we've overlooked on this is Union Pacific. Because Union Pacific, I know when the high-speed rail was coming through here, they showed how powerful they are by blocking any access to their easement. And I was personally told by the person that was leading the development of the high-speed rail project that the lobby and the lobby power that Union Pacific and the railroads have in general, you are never going to get them to bend your way. But because they are very powerful and they do have a lot of money, that maybe the funding for doing the road grading and stuff like that can, the lion's share of that could probably be picked up by the railroad to give access for emergency vehicles to the east side of this community. So it might be a good idea to maybe reach out to Union Pacific to see if we can get some dialogue with them to see if there's any kind of funding on their end for helping out on this. I personally dealt with Union Pacific one time before when I was on the RCSB board, and that's the crossing over at Patterson. When that truck came out of the from behind those hedges or bushes there that were along the railroad tracks and got hit by the train because there was not a controlled crossing there at that time. Union Pacific told, but we needed Patterson to get to our sewage treatment plant. That was our access. And Union Pacific just flat out came out and said, you pay for the crossing. We'll install it, but you pay for the equipment. And, or we'll just shut it down.
You gotta remember that the railroads got their charter from the federal government, and yeah, that trumps everything else, so that's why they
did it. And so they are hard to deal with. But I think if we put enough money on the bread, maybe we can get them to, on a humanitarian level, maybe help us out a little bit here.
Who
Greg, I need to find my map. When we were doing CERT team, they had a federal person come out and talk with us, and they actually did the stopping. When we have a natural disaster here, the stop was the railroad tracks to decide going towards the base was going to be handled by the base. Anything coming over in this direction was going to be handled by us. And we trained that way. We went Saturday after Saturday and trained that way. And there is a map.
You're right. You know, major train derailment or stuff like that. But what we're concerned about is train comes through here and stops. We had it happen one time when the train was there. And somebody over here has a 911 call. The base isn't going to respond to that. And that person could end up dying because they can't get help to them. That's what we have to try to find a solution for just everyday responses from the fire department to put out a fire, to respond to a medical emergency, for the police to respond to injury accidents, any of this stuff, is that to have some way for them to, okay, I can't go down Roosevelt Boulevard, boom, I'll go this way. At least they can get there. And that's where the county, I know, is going to say they don't have the money. But, and as far as getting volunteers to do it.
Wasn't there one on Marie Street already? Did they put a Marie Street crossing in?
Say what?
There's a crossing at Marie Street.
It's
Patterson. Patterson Avenue A.
I thought there was a talk about putting one on Marie Street.
There was one. But the real thing is that what we need to look at is that Patterson is good. But you know, some of these trains, you know, they're a mile, 2 miles long.
Well, what Mike needs to understand when he goes back to the county is that Marie is 1 mile south of Roosevelt Boulevard and Patterson is 2 miles south of Roosevelt Boulevard. Both should be put into play.
Right. But the thing is that if we can just, the sewage treatment plant's good. We've got a good road from Patterson, from Sierra Highway to the sewage treatment plant. It's once you turn north from there, that's what we need to have graded and maintained.
Yeah, we need a north-south connector.
On 15th Street West.
Well, or 10th, whatever.
Yeah.
But
it's actually United Street.
United / 10th.
Yeah.
Exactly. But and the railroad is not going to go along with any more at-grade crossing. They'll fight that to the last man.
I've seen a train break down 5 times, and I've never seen Patterson block. I've gone around that way.
Right.
I've gone around, but you know, we've got about 1,000 people living in that area now.
Well, certainly the idea of, you know, grading either 15th or 10th or
I know in reality that
is, you know,
the county isn't going to loan the equipment.
But
if we have the operator that can run, like Paul can run the equipment, county's not going to loan the equipment. And we're not going to get a construction company that's going to come in and donate the equipment and the volunteer. It's a pipe dream. It's not going to work. I know that.
I had a question. Question on your planning committee. Are there any proposals to the current county planning department that came out last month?
No. But this has been an ongoing conversation.
I saw one. Came through to me on it. And I don't know why don't you get it? It's over on, it's west of 40th, north of the apartments are by the Sky Park Market.
Okay.
I think it's called the Crossing. The same company wants to put in 18 more apartments, which is cool, but that should have come to 40th.
The last time I talked to Lorelei on that, it was going to be a market value apartment complex going in.
Right, but it should have gone to you is what I'm saying. You didn't get it.
We haven't gotten it yet because it was still in the planning stages. They haven't even pulled permits to actually start construction.
Well, I've got paperwork sent to my office 2 days ago. So
okay. Then we should be hearing something pretty soon.
Yeah, let's check.
But I have been, on a regular basis, I do talk to Lorelei to, you know, get an update on any kind of new construction going on, and we have an agreement with her that when it's actually going to happen, and she will come and she will apprise the board and the community of, you know, this is coming in, so that way we're aware of changes happening in the community.
Well, any planning document, I thought that would take you want to get a comment.
We probably need to get the loop a little earlier, so we have to get our input.
Yeah, before.
Before they spend a lot of money. In this case, it's probably that deal is not that big an issue.
I do know that there was concern about Section 8 housing, and she assured me that it's not Section 8 housing.
The cross is definitely not Section 8.
Market value apartments, which is a more the merrier, I guess. That's fine. Okay, so anyhow, I think with the planning committee on this, I think we've got some ideas of moving forward with this, so we can go that way.
One more question for the comment section's over with.
Who can the comment section's already over.
No, I'm sorry. I wanted to know.
We're in the business meeting now, and we're talking about specific things. Okay. Right now, we're talking on the planning committee. Okay, and then item B, safety committee, any reports?
No.
Okay, item C, public health and community welfare?
Nothing.
Any reports? Public works. Parkman, any reports on this?
It's actually covered a little bit further down under old business, but just wanted to get an update on the crosswalk at Eagle Way and Rosemont Boulevard.
Okay. And, all right, we'll cover that when we get down. Okay, Public Relations Committee?
No.
Nothing? Okay, item 11, old business. Discuss and take possible action regarding marijuana dispensaries. Any reports on this matter at this time? All right, then item B. Shoulder repair on 35th, looks like that can
come
off the agenda now.
I had a question on that for Mike. You said 35th was done and 40th was done. 55th Street, which is Moffitt Traffic Road Extended, has the same problem with big gaps in that north-south road. Was that taken care of as well? Was that correct, Bill?
I didn't see it on the completed public works list, so probably not.
Okay, we could look into that. That should have been done.
All right, then item C, discuss take possible action regarding unsignaled crosswalk at Rosen Boulevard and Eagle Way.
There you go.
There you go, sir.
Do you have anything?
That's a pass the buck.
It's nothing more than what you see here. That it is, that Caltrans and the county are in communication on it, and it's going to be... it's going to be done.
Oh, that's the ADA crosswalk. I'm talking about the one right above it, the unsignaled crosswalk.
See?
The one right there talking about.
Rosemont Boulevard, yeah. Eagle Way.
Yeah, last month you were telling us that the county was going to take a look at it. Now the county
I don't have any.
There's
I don't,
a problem.
That's right, talking about in the school district, right? Eagle Way is at the end of the
it's
school.
It's right there at the high school.
It's right there at the high school, the district offices.
I don't have an update on that since last month, no.
Okay.
But it's in the pipeline there. So
okay. I have to tell you, I was recently driving around, don't ask me where because I don't remember at the time, but I actually saw one of those flashing light things and it really caused me to stop, and I'm sure the car behind me did not like that because I've never seen one before. But those flashing lights make you stop.
Mojave has them up on Business 58.
I wasn't in Mojave.
Yeah, they've got one on 15th Street.
I don't know where.
Not 15th Street, Lancaster Boulevard, about halfway down the
line. Oh, yeah, between 10th and 11th.
There's
or 10th
one there. There's also one on 10th Street West, I believe, that runs that wide street. So they have the ability to span the roadways.
Well, another thing, too, that I think is nice is with stop signs up in Ridgecrest, if you're going down China Lake Boulevard or I think it's Ridgecrest Boulevard. I'm not. My son lives there. I just know which way to get to his house. But anyhow, if you're going down a main boulevard in Ridgecrest, the stop signs all have the blinking red lights around the stop signs, and they're visible day and night, and it's a nice little tool, and I'd like to see some of those in our community just to make the stop signs a little more visible so that people know they're there and less chance of somebody getting hurt. And they're all run on solar power and it's sunshine's free.
We got a lot of
okay, so Anyhow, I guess you're going to look into that, Mike?
Yeah, I mean, it's already in my report, okay. And Zach knows about it. It just hasn't come back to me yet with what they're going to do.
Oh, okay. Okay, and then item D, discuss and take possible action in regards to lack of ADA accessibility on Roseland Boulevard overpass walkways. And Bill?
Yeah, the one thing I had told the CalDOT was that there are portions of that work on that overpass that they could do now. It doesn't require a great deal of skill sets. All they need is a grinder to grind down the asphalt so that it transitions to the curb face better, or to the concrete. Because if you're in a motorized chair, you're going on an e-ticket ride when you get down to the west side of Rosamond Boulevard there, on the north side of it.
We won't charge
for that. I'm confused by what it says.
The overpass.
The overpass. It's the overpass. When you go over the overpass.
Oh, the freeway. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And there's places where they have little mini crosswalks. And the asphalt looks like what it has happened over time. It has heated up and it's buckled.
Yeah, I've seen it.
And that's something that can be done right away. It doesn't have to wait till 2020.
I'm not sure why, Bill. It might be just the that's the soonest that the.
It's Caltrans. It's not the county. That's
Caltrans was there last week, actually. What did they do?
Assess the situation.
Yeah, it's probably not.
I couldn't tell you. They haven't touched those problem areas I'm talking about.
Mike, why don't you see if you can set up a meeting with Caltrans like we had for the off-ramp? We set up a meeting here with them, sat down face to face, and we got some pretty rapid movement on getting stuff done. So maybe something like this, we can talk to them
again,
because this looks to me like the lady from Caltrans said at the time, this is more of like just a work order where they can just come in and make a asphalt repair right there where it doesn't require major construction and thousands of dollars. They can have a crew come out, they can spend half the day out there fixing it and be done with it. And maybe just getting a little face-to-face with them. I've got her card at home. I will send you the contact information, and I think we can get this done a lot quicker than 2020.
Okay.
Yay.
I'll follow up on it.
Okay. Okay, item E, discuss, take possible action regarding county increase in park recreation opportunities in Roseland, including repairs and children's playground areas. Are we still on schedule to get that playground area repaired as they promised?
Yes, as far as I know, nothing's changed.
Nothing's changed.
Yeah, I talked to the head of the general services, and Jeffrey Hill, he told me it's going to be done in July or August at the latest.
Okay.
This is
great. Okay, and update on the community Christmas toy giveaway. We are having our meeting next week. So anybody interested, please be there.
Be
here, 7 o'clock, and Wednesday. And I know Lisa can't wait to be there.
I can't, sorry.
Meeting next Wednesday.
Meeting is next Wednesday.
Wednesday, 7 o'clock.
7 o'clock.
And I know Mr. Jack can't wait to be there too, and Albert already left.
I'm glad you reminded me, because that didn't carry over to my phone.
Yep, next Wednesday.
Donna, also I need help to open that program.
Yeah, I keep saying that.
Okay, item 12, new business, there is none. Item 13, director agenda referrals. Director Hernandez.
I do appreciate, though, Paul just mentioning, I know he's gone already, but the things that maybe we should start looking at, and I know some of you have already done that, but I definitely need to get a little more involved in that.
We've been meaning to talk to you about that.
Okay.
Real lower your
pants. Right?
You guys around all of them.
Director Morris?
Nope, nothing.
Director Parkman?
Nope.
I just want to make sure that this north-south connector between Patterson or Avenue A and Roseland Boulevard, maybe 10th or 15th or so, on the agenda. So we can keep track of this.
We'll keep track of that. We'll be kept on the agenda.
Yeah. This is... He's got a good point.
All right, director comments. Any director comments? I just want to thank all of you for coming out this evening, and I want to thank you for your input. It's very important in this this board, and helps us better serve you. And I want to thank Paul for standing up and holding our feet to the fire a little bit, because sometimes we need that. And
yeah, we certainly appreciate our law enforcement folks. Thank you.
Yes.
You know, you guys do a great job. I know you were expecting probably snacks.
It was your turn.
Oh, it's my turn.
Dennis and I ate them all on the way here.
You know, along that line, since January, I've to my own little horn here, I've lost close to 54 pounds on Weight Watchers. So if any of you are thinking about looking into that, I can get you a free month. See me after.
Okay, item 15, adjournment.
I make a motion to leave.
Second. Okay, motion made by Director Morris, second by Director Wright. All in favor?
Aye.
We are adjourned.